Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me and you. We all were lost, but now we are found. I just want us to think about the lyrics of this song. We were blind, but now we can see. We don't have to stumble again, church. Glory be to God. Amazing grace.
Hallelujah.
And everything that we go through, the blessings that are poured upon us day by day, it is through God's amazing grace.
Hallelujah.
His amazing grace. Abundant grace.
Hallelujah.
How will you give him praise for his grace?
Yes.
You see, God wants to give us everything that is good.
Yes.
I'm here to tell you that. Because I know it is true.
Yes.
He wants to give his people, every child that was born and created on this earth. He wants to give everyone good. He wants to bestow upon us everything that is good.
Hallelujah.
That is the nature of Almighty God. Because in Jeremiah 29 from 11 to 13, hear what the word of God declares. It says, for I know the thoughts that I think toward you,
yes,
says the Lord.
Yes.
Thoughts of peace,
my Lord,
and not evil. Mm-hmm. To give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you.
Amen.
And you will seek me and find me. When you search for me with all of your heart, I am going to entitle this message this morning, this is truly not it.
Amen.
This is truly not it.
Amen.
Because God has bigger plans for his people.
Hallelujah.
We look on our lives and no matter what's going on in it,
yes,
sometimes it is but it is not it. You see, I was in prayer and God gave me this word. And I tell you, when I got the word from God, and he started to mirror everything that was going on, and he says, my child, this is truly not it. He says, what you see now is not what I have in plan for you. Because if I'm telling you, I'm telling it to all my children. No matter what is going on. No matter what is going on. I want you to tell yourself and tell the situation. Speak to the situation and tell it that this is truly not it. I know that my God and my Father has bigger plans. I know that he has greater things in store. So if you're even enjoying good things now, guess what? It still remains that this is truly not it. Because God wants to take you to higher places. No matter what you think you are going through, he's going to change it.
Yes.
God gave me this word. And I tell you, I when I was in his presence, I praised him with everything that I had in me. Because I said, God, you're truly a good father. You're truly a God who keeps your children intact. And you want to assure their hearts from time to time to let them know that you have bigger things in store for them. No matter how the situation looks, no matter how it looks crazy, no matter how it looks like it's out of alignment with what God had promised you, I am here to tell you that that's what the word of God says, and that's what his direction is to his servant today, to tell you that this It is truly not it.
Amen.
So when the devil creates issues in your life, when you look all around you and you see discouragement, when you examine your life and all that you have done in the past, you have done everything. You have worked hard. You pray. You stay in the word of God. You bless him and you praise him. And you seek a relationship with him. And when you look, your whole world is still turning upside down. But I am here, my God, to encourage you this morning, as thus said the Lord, to look at the situation, stare it in the eye, and say, this is truly not it. It is going to get better, I can tell you that, church. And I believe it in my whole heart. If I believe it, I'm going to speak it, because it is so. I'm going to take you, my God, to Luke 16, from verses 19 to 31. That is the scripture that I want you to look at. And at the time, my God, the word talks about a man that is called Lazarus. And when Lazarus looked at his life, the Lazarus was in a very bad place. My God Almighty, the man looked and he had nothing to eat. He had to beg. The word says he was covered with sores. Can you imagine? So I know that when Lazarus was going through his thing, that Lazarus could never believe that this was truly not it. Lazarus thought at the time that this is how it's gonna be, my God. There can be nothing better than this. This is going to kill me and take me out. And when I go out, I'm going to be the same. I will be dead in that grave. And there will be the end of my life. But I am here to tell you, my God, that the word of God says that Lazarus died. Let me just read the word quickly, because we didn't read it this morning. Hear what the word says. It says, there was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. But there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, who was full of sores, who was laid at his gate, desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. And moreover, the dogs came and licked his sore. So it was that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And being in torments in Hades, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom.
Yes.
So the two men who were on earth, and they were enjoying different lives.
Yes.
Lazarus was in torment then.
Yes.
And the rich man thought that this was it. That I am going to enjoy forever.
Yes.
But it flipped in the last minute. It flipped in the final end. And God is going to flip some things, my God, as you go through your thing and you think that this is it. God is going to flip it and to let you know that this truly is not it.
Amen, amen.
I have better things.
Yes.
When folks declare and tell you that this is it, you tell them that truly this is not it. Because God is saying something else. That God is going to flip the situation. And what seemed bad is going to become good.
Amen.
To the glory of Almighty God.
Amen.
You see, I hate when man give as if they have the final say. Have zero tolerance for it. I get very, very upset when folks speak and think that they the final authority.
Yes.
Because you have some folks, you know, who love to talk like they know it all. And they don't know who is Jehovah God. They have never heard that he is the only true and living God. So they will talk as if they had the final say. But children of God, the fact that amazing grace comes to you and that your eyes are opened, you're no longer blind, and that you were saved by the blood of Jesus Christ, that God Almighty called you out of the deep cesspool of sin and clothed you with his righteousness, then you must declare it with authority. When folks talk like they know that they know. When folks talk like they have the final say and that they're the ultimate authority. You need to just look at them and flip that script back to them.
Amen.
And let them know that
Amen. This
is truly not it.
Amen.
As I got that topic for the message, I remember Michael Jackson, because he had, before he departed, he had some kind of thing that he had to go, and it was, this is it. But you and I know what happened. Didn't make it to that final affair that he thought was, this is it. God was saying, my son, this is truly not it. Ah, my. If God's people at all times can give the ultimate credence to Jehovah God and to let him know that he is in total control. God knows that he is in control already. But it is for us to acknowledge that before Jehovah God. Humble ourselves before him. Because Lazarus did that.
Yes.
While Lazarus was suffering, he went through his suffering.
Yes.
He didn't ask God to let him walk on top of the suffering, you see. He went through it. Sometimes we're going through our things and we want to walk on top of it as opposed to going through it. But the word of God is saying that I will be with you.
Yes.
Amen.
I will be with you as you're going through it. As you're passing through the rivers.
Yes.
I will be with you and it will not overflow you, because truly this is not it.
Amen.
What you see now does not define the future plans that God Almighty has for you and I. The word says that Abraham had Lazarus in his bosom, but the rich man died and entered into the grave. The both of them took one exit, but they ended up in different directions. You see, God's people must know that God has a direction for your life. And despite the fact that you might pass into some rough waters, that he is with you.
Amen.
And it is for us to stay the course.
Yes.
It is for us to remember the promises of Almighty God.
Yes.
It is for us to hold tight to his unchanging arms. And don't give up. Don't give up. And don't give in. Because the word today for you is, this is truly not it.
Amen.
It's going to change, church.
Amen.
There's a time for everything.
Amen.
There are different seasons. Seasons come and seasons go. And as they go, listen to me, it is going to usher in whatever God has in store for you and I. So the rich man called out to Abraham and says, listen, I want you to flip the script for me and send Lazarus that he can take a little water to tip on my lips because I'm burning where I'm at. But Abraham says, hey, listen, there was a time when Lazarus was enjoying the bad things you see in life.
Yes, you
and you were having a great time.
Mm-hmm.
So now the script is flipped.
Mm-hmm.
And it is for you to understand that this is truly it for you. But Lazarus, on the other hand, he has now understood that this is truly, that was truly not it. See, God has his plans for his people. And it is for us, my children, to understand who this God is. Because Jesus told his disciples in Matthew 19 from 23 to 30. Hear what Jesus said to his children, his disciples. He says, then Jesus said to his disciples, assuredly I say to you that it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Because you see, they keep their eyes on things of the earth. They think, truly this is it for me. But the word of God is saying today, truly this is not it. Because at some point, it is going to flip. Mm-hmm. And when it flips, if you were on the enjoying side of life, if you're enjoying life and having a great time, not allowing yourself to come to know who God is.
Amen.
You're going to understand that. That's how it works. And it says again, I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. When his disciples heard it, they were greatly astonished, saying, who then can be saved? But Jesus looked at them and said to them, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible.
Amen.
God is able to change things.
Amen.
That's what the word is saying.
Lord.
It says, therefore, then Peter answered and said to him, see, we have left all and followed you. Therefore, what shall we have? So Jesus said to them, assuredly I say to you that in the regeneration, when the Son of Man sits on the throne of his glory, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my name's sake shall receive a hundredfold and inherit eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first. So in the whole this manner of things, as life is unraveling itself, as children of God, we have to make some choices. Yes. Sometimes it's really hard choices that we have to make. Because I've seen some folks who started out well. But because of certain things going on. Because sometimes wives say you can't do this. And husbands say you can't do that. And children might be standing in the way. We make some very stupid decisions. These decisions that we make sometimes compromise what the Word of God wants us to do. And that's the real truth, church. Sometimes in the whole mix of things, we decide to want to grapple to certain things that the eyes can now see. But what's in the latter rain, my God, the things that are invisible, we take our eyes off those things. And we have to be careful, says the Spirit of God. We have to be very careful. We have to surrender everything to God. We have to surrender our lives to the Almighty God. Day by day, we should try to just empty ourselves before God. And as we empty ourselves, some of the things that we seem to think that we have to grapple and to hold on to, some of the things that continue to perplex us, we would just release it to the Almighty God, because we would know that we are not able to change those things. And what we cannot change, we have to pray and ask God to give us the wisdom to understand that. And when we can't change things, then we have to surrender it to Jehovah God. because God has a time for everything. Seasons again, they come and they go. We shouldn't worry then about life. Whatever is going on in our lives, whatever we are faced with, don't waste the time to worry about it. In the human flesh, we are human, and sometimes we will visit it. But church, we should not stay when we visit. Make a short visit and walk away from it. Leave it. That's it. We need to do that. We understand that this is a bigger thing, bigger than us. And we need to know who to surrender it to Jehovah God, because he don't tell us that this truly is not it.
Amen.
So we release it to him and continue to trust him, continue to wait patiently on him.
Amen.
Until it comes to pass.
Amen.
Whatever he's going to bring into pass. We can all testify about that.
Yes.
But we have been in some hard times sometimes.
Yes.
Some very rough times. Sometimes we feel like we're throwing the towel. Yes, because we are human beings.
Yes.
The human side of us sometimes want to just give it up. But God is saying to you today, this is truly not it, that you are to go forward. You have to move forward and to follow his direction. Because Matthew 6, 31 to 34 says, therefore do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? And what shall we drink? Can you imagine that? Or what shall we wear? For after these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows what you need. And all these things, God knew. He knows them before they come to us as an awareness. That is Jehovah God. For he says, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow. For tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is, it is its own trouble. So church, let us keep our eyes on Jesus. Let us understand that God is in total control. And even though we might find ourselves at a very low place, my God Almighty, it will not continue to be like that. Because the word of God talks about the young boy from when he was age 5, that he had a very bad situation. Something happened to him. Because the word of God says in Samuel, 2 Samuel chapter 4, it talks about Jonathan's son, Mephibosheth. A young boy was carried by her attendant. The woman who was taking care of him, the caregiver. Once she heard that Saul and Jonathan had died in this battle, that the woman picked up this young boy at age 5 and started to run with him. And as she fled, my God, she fell and the boy dropped and became lame. And she ran to Lodibar. And you know what Lodibar can give? Lodibar is a place of nothingness. Here was this boy, a son of a king, grandson of a king, King Saul. And now he found himself. He didn't go there by choice, but he was taken there. Sometimes we get to some place in life. Sometimes we face some issues in life, and it has nothing to do with our own doing.
My Lord.
I can tell you that. We can find ourselves in some situations, and it is because of who we know or who we have. They bring us to these places, my God. A place of Lodibar. A place of sadness. A place of nothingness. My God Almighty. And we can be in these places. Somebody can drop you there.
My Lord.
You didn't plan to be in those situations, the things that we face at times, but we didn't plan to be going through those things. But guess what? Somebody dropped us there. Somebody dropped us in that situation. Somebody caused us to be facing this situation. Who dropped you in those places? It is for you to find out. But I am here to declare this morning that it truly is not it. Whatever you're facing, whoever dropped you into a situation for Mephibosheth, it changed after a while, because the word of God says in 2 Samuel 9 from verses 1 to 13, and I'm going to read that word for you to hear what happened to this young boy who now grew up at Lodibar, a place of hardship, a place of nothingness. And the word says, now David said, is there still anyone who is left of the house of Saul that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake? Ah, my. Oh, glory be to God. And there was a servant of the house of Saul whose name was Ziba. So when they had called him to David, the king said to him, are you Ziba? And he said, at your service. Then the king said, is there not still someone of the house of Saul to whom I may show the kindness of God? Can you imagine? This young man from age 5 was crippled and brought into a place of nothingness. But there came the time. He thought that that would be it for him. But the time came, my God, and David now was on the throne. David had preceded Saul, my God, and he now wanted to show kindness because of Jonathan. Jonathan, whom David had loved. Jonathan, who they both had made a treaty that they would watch out for each other. Amen. And Ziba said to the king, there is still a son of Jonathan who is lame in his feet. So the king said to him, where is he? And Ziba said to the king, indeed, he is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, in Lodibar. And the king David sent and brought him out of the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, from Lodibar. Now when Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, had come to David, he fell on his face and prostrated himself. And then David said to Mephibosheth, and he answered, here is your servant. So David said to him, do not fear, for I will surely show you kindness for Jonathan, your father's sake. And will restore you all the land of Saul, your grandfather. And you shall eat bread at my table continually. Can you imagine that? From a place of nothingness. And it changed like that. The script was flipped. Oh yes. That is the God that we serve, church. No matter what we're going through, look at it and tell it, this is truly not it. Because I can imagine for that man, Mephibosheth, he thought that it was it. He thought that he was finishing Lodibar. Nobody would ever remember him. How could he get out of this place of nothingness? But God had a plan. Oh yes, Jehovah God, who was speaking to his situation, had a plan for him.
Amen.
And it changed. Instead of nothingness, he was at the king's table. Feasting at the king's table.
Amen.
And that's the God that we serve. Only if we could trust Jehovah God like that. Oh yes, he's ready to change some situation that you're going through. He's ready to change things in your life. 2 Corinthians 4, 7 to 10. It's the word says, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels. You see, God revealed that word to me the other day too. And I jumped and hooped like I'd never know what to do with myself. He says, we have this treasure in earthen vessels. Vessels of earthenware. That the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. Ha! Oh yes, we are hard pressed on every side. But because of this treasure that is in us. Hallelujah. The light of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. The power of the Holy Spirit of God. Hallelujah. That lives in us. Yes. He says because of that. He says we are hard pressed on every side. Yet we are not crushed. Amen. It will change because this is not it. We are perplexed but not in despair. Persecuted but not forsaken. Because God has a plan for us. Amen. Shut down but not destroyed.
Amen.
How many times you have been struck down?
My Lord.
And you keep getting up.
Hallelujah.
When you think you aren't able to make it. Yeah. When you thought that this would be it. Yeah. Oh, I will be taken out. Hallelujah. By this thing. And you keep coming back.
Hallelujah.
Let's look at our lives and examine it, church. And we can be agreeing with this word today. That this is truly not it. Mm. Yes. He says, we are persecuted but not forsaken. Struck down but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus Christ. That the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body.
Hallelujah.
Yes, church.
Lord.
This is truly not it.
Hallelujah.
Oh, glory to God. It is so much for us to be excited about. It is so much for us to give God thanks for.
Yes.
That God has another plan. That's the reality of it. That's the real deal. That he has another plan.
Yes.
That we can't see yet.
My Lord.
But very soon, it will be manifested in the natural. That's how God works.
Hallelujah.
That is how God Almighty works. So I am very excited. I can stand day by day and face the world. And face whatever is in my life.
Yes.
I can face it.
Yes.
And I can tell it, look it in the eye. And says, this is truly not it.
Amen.
So you better find your way out of my life.
Amen.
You gotta find your exit. That's how you found the entrance to come in. You better take that exit and get out of here. Because this is truly not it. God has told me that it is not it. And if God says it, I'm going to believe it.
Yes, amen.
Only God's people can know what he has in store for us.
Amen.
Oh, glory be to God. Only God could show us a little around behind the curtain.
My Lord.
He can show us all of it, you see. Because if he shows us all of it, some of us would run and hide. I can tell you that. Some of us will perhaps just get a pulp in and people would think she is crazy or he's crazy. But I'm here to tell you, church, you can jump and prance. Because when God showed me that the other morning, oh, I was just jumping and shouting and prancing. I couldn't do better because I was excited in the spirit to know that God Almighty says, wait, whatever you see around you, this is not it. Don't pay attention to what your natural eyes are showing you. You got to look in the spiritual, you see. Put on your spiritual lens and look at what God is saying. The word in John 14 from 1 to 6 says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. I have a lot of different things that I can pour out upon you. If this was not so, I would have told you. He says, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. I will be with you. I'm not going to leave you.
Amen.
I will never leave you nor forsake you. I go to make bigger plans because I'm going now in the presence of my Heavenly Father to talk you. And I'm going to call all of your names before Jehovah come. Come on, church. What else do we want? What other promises can God give to us to make us excited in the spirit and want to jump and prance and burst forth with the joy of the Lord? I say God has big plans.
Yes, amen.
For us.
Yes, Lord.
And it is enough for us to give God the glory. It is enough for us to get up each morning and face the world. No matter what is coming at you, you can face it and look at it in the eye and say, oh, this is truly not it. I know that something else is around the corner. So I am going to wait on my God. David knew how to wait on God.
Yes.
When David was faced with all the persecutions in life, Saul wanted to kill him, running him night and day like a fugitive. And the man had a faith in God to know that this truly is not it. The man said in Psalm 27, he says, I would have lost heart. If I had not known that this was truly not it, I would have lost heart.
Hallelujah.
If I had not believed that I would see the goodness of God in the land of the living. He says, don't wait, Terrence, wait for it. Because he shall renew your strength. He will renew your strength, church. He will take you through the deep waters. He will take you through it. This is truly not it. All you have to do is stay your course and hold on to Jehovah God. Don't you let go of him. And he will take you through those deep waters. Oh yes, he's that God, I tell you. Oh my God Almighty, if folks could have just seen what God has in store. 1 Corinthians 2, 1 verses 1 says, but as it is written, eye has not seen, or nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. God has some things in store.
Amen.
That we cannot even conceive. That's God. He wants to bless his people.
Yes.
He wants to give us different situations that will propel us and to strengthen us. He knows how to build our faith. He knows how to take us through those hard times. That's the work of Almighty God. Our thing is just to trust and to hold on to him. That's all we have to do, church. We don't have to worry ourselves. We don't have to worry ourselves. We don't have to lose sleepless nights. Whatever the situation is, I might not know what you're going through. And neither you know what I'm going through. But there's one thing I can tell you. There's one common denominator in this whole idea and the whole fact of life is that this is truly not it.
Amen.
So whatever you are going through,
amen,
by faith, believe that God has bigger plans,
yes,
bigger things,
amen,
to set forth. And I'm going to use this scripture to close. 1 Peter 5, from 8 to 11. The word says then, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks around like a roaring lion. He's in all those things. And he wants to mess your mind up to tell you that this is it. But you must be vigilant and be sober, the word says, because he's roaring like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. The word says, resist him. Tell him to get away from you. Resist him and be steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are expected experienced by your brotherhood in the world. But may the God of all grace, who called us to eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, may perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you.
Amen.
To him be the glory and the dominion forever and ever and ever. And may the church now say amen to that word.
Amen.
Father, we praise
amen.
You.
Amen.
And we give you the glory, Lord. And we honor you, mighty God. And we thank you that you have plans for our lives. You have plans for situations that perplex us. You have everything all worked out already, mighty God. I pray, Lord, as your children are going through the storms of life, that God, that you will strengthen them. You will comfort their hearts. You will perfect them, Lord, God Almighty, and that you will keep them, Heavenly Father. Father, we thank you and praise you. Hallelujah. And we give you the glory. And we honor you, mighty God, for this word. May you use this word, Lord, to strengthen a heart this morning. And lift up souls that are broken and subdued. Those who will watch by the internet. God, we pray that you will use your word and let the power of your Holy Spirit use it, Lord, to do as you please. We thank you, we praise you. And we honor you and worship you. And we give you the glory. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior.
Hallelujah.
And God's children will agree and say, amen and amen.